So the Sotheby's 2018 top tier fall forecast real estate report is out. And when we're talking about that fall forecast, you typically touch on that $1 million plus market, condos, single family homes in that luxury, I guess, sector. And I'm just wondering, what is the conclusion of that report? I mean, did you see sales affected? Because the beginning of the year, we saw, you know, new mortgage rules. We saw federal and provincial measures being introduced. Did that affect luxury home buyers?
So the short answer is that the effect has been inconsistent across the country. And there's no question that in Toronto and in Vancouver, certainly for the first half of the year, we saw the market slow down. So the number of homes being bought and sold slowed down during that time period. But during the summer in Toronto, for example, we actually saw the number of homes being sold on a year-over-year basis actually start to increase. And we're expecting that to continue on into the fall market.
And how do you translate that at the beginning of the year? I mean, I don't, indulge me here for a moment, I don't typically think that these federal and provincial measures that were introduced, that they would typically affect that type of home buyer, if you will. But were they gauging what was going on in the market? Help me kind of translate that.
I think the, speaking about Toronto just for a second, the first quarter of 2017 was a historical high in terms of the number of homes being bought and sold. So every year-over-year comparison is compared to
last
historical
year.
High.
Right.
So the first quarter of 17 versus 18 showed a precipitous drop in the number of homes sold in Toronto. The second quarter started picking up, but because the first quarter was included, the first half compared to the second half still looked very, very tough. So what we've been looking at is the month-over-month change. And what we've been seeing there is that the number of homes being bought and sold has started to increase coming out of that time period. And I think once at the end of the year, you'll see that the number of homes sold, bought and sold in Toronto is a very healthy number, but it will still pale in comparison to 2017 because of that very strong first quarter.
So now you touched on Toronto. Let's talk about Vancouver, Montreal, Calgary, these cities.
Yeah. And again, very, very different dynamics going on. In Vancouver, they implemented their foreign buyer tax in the summer of 2016. And it was, for the most part, a surprise to the market. And as a consequence, activity levels in all categories, price categories, slowed down because the psychology of the market was, what's going to happen next? Is this going to cause a significant shift in the demand for housing? Is the government going to do something else? And then the market gradually started to come back, particularly in the condominium sector. But in March of this year, the provincial government of BC put in additional policy measures to try and address the housing market, expanded the foreign buyer tax to a much bigger geography, introduced the notion of a speculation tax, introduced the notion of additional property taxes. And that has had an incredibly chilling effect on that marketplace, to the point where the activity levels continue to decrease on a month-over-month and year-over-year basis.
Calgary, Montreal.
So Calgary, let's start with Calgary. There's a perfect example of a market whose fundamental economic driver, you know, the price of oil in the oil industry, has been struggling for the last number of years. And even in that situation, the Calgary market, whilst it's slow and the activity levels are slow, has been remarkably resilient in terms of pricing. Yes, prices are off from the peak of 2014, but we're still seeing transactions occur and we're still seeing some healthy activity there. Montreal is a very interesting market. So Montreal, as all the other markets, have been affected by all of the federal policies. So mortgage distress testing, the interest rates increases, etc. It does not have a foreign buyer's tax or any of the other dynamics there. And it's also been a very stable political market for so many years now that it's starting to come into its own. And people are recognizing the value that you can get for buying something in Montreal compared to Toronto and Vancouver is quite remarkable. And so there's a belief that the prices are going to continue to move upward in those marketplaces as they play catch-up with some of the other markets.
I want to go back to the West Coast simply because I guess we always associate the West Coast with foreign buyers. And have you seen a drop in interest from investors at all? coming, I guess, from China or from other countries as well.
Yeah, so the notion of the foreign buyer is one that's talked about a lot. It is a factor in the marketplace, but it's by no means the largest factor. Stats Canada now reports regularly on the number and percentages of foreign buyers in the all Canadian markets. And they've estimated that in Vancouver, and particularly in condos, because that tends to be more where people invest, that it might be as much as 7 or maybe even 9%. And we've seen it tail off a little bit, but not much off of that. The other thing about the foreign buyer tax is it doesn't apply to all foreign buyers. It's essentially people that don't live in Canada and don't pay taxes in Canada. They're the ones that are affected by that foreign buyer tax, and that is a very, very small percentage of the marketplace. There's no question that we've seen a modest increase in activity in Montreal from foreign buyers. It's not necessarily just because of the tax. Montreal is the second largest city in Canada to attract immigration. It's a phenomenal place for kids to go to school, and so we're seeing more and more of that as the population rises both organically and as a result of immigration.
Any outlandish incentives, like we'll give you a Rolex if you buy this condo, we'll give you a car if you buy this home?
No, you know, developers don't really have to do that because there's such a strong demand, particularly for condominiums, because condominiums is the asset class right now that has the largest number of people looking at it. You have first-time home buyers, you have actually early family formation buyers, you have downsizers, and you have investors. So all four of those categories of people are looking at condominiums as an asset of choice, if you like, as opposed to an asset of necessity.
There was a global index that came out earlier in 2018, and specifically in the summer, with respect to Vancouver and Toronto no longer being up there on that list when it comes to luxury housing. So I guess those markets are kind of losing steam. Do we care?
It's an interesting question, and I think we tend to look at Canada and particularly Toronto, Vancouver, and go, oh my gosh, it's so unaffordable and it's so expensive. But when you compare those two markets to a New York or a San Francisco or a Los Angeles or Paris or any number of other global cities, Toronto, Vancouver, Canada more broadly, is a very affordable choice. You then look at a stable political system, you look at a world-class education system, quality of air, amount of space that people have, and it still continues to be a very attractive place for people to want to come and live and work.